This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
What is up? How y'all doing today? Happy Tuesday. I'm Maggie Daun. You're listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. I come to you from the WAUK in southeastern Wisconsin, but you can check the show out throughout the state on your local Civic Media talk radio station, but you can always go get that app as the holidays arrive. Wouldn't it be a gift to give real news and great conversation to each and every one of your friends and family? You can do that by hooking them up with the Civic Media app and a little bit of the Civic Media swag. Again, I like the stuff from the AUK, but you can catch it for all of our stations and hook up you and yours for your holiday gift-giving needs. You just go to the Civic Media website at civicmedia.us, and in that top right-hand corner, click on store. You'll find the swag for all of your favorite local Civic Media radio stations. We certainly have real news and great conversation for you all today. You're going to join this fine program at 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. Let me tell you what I got cooked up this afternoon for each and every one of you. I recently traveled to St. Louis last week to speak at a conference there. And I'm going to be joined by Civic Media's very own political editor, Dan Schaefer. At 3 o'clock, we're going to talk a bit about that conference, also about the recent interview that Assembly Speaker Robin Voss gave this past weekend, some of the things that he had to say, especially in light of the Office of Lawyer Regulation 10-count complaint that was filed against former state Supreme Court Justice Michael Gableman for the things he said and did related to the $2.3 million waste of taxpayer money pseudo investigation that Gableman was supposed to conduct into the 2020 election. I'm going to talk about all that with Dan at three. But I got to start today with a little of airport hijinks related to my recent trip to St. Louis. I seem to always get into some such nonsense when I'm flying. And I used to fly a lot more. I still travel a little bit now and again for work. I'm going to tell you all about what went down when I was trying to catch my flight home. I'm going to talk about the tariffs. Donald Trump making waves yesterday, signaling that on day one, he's going to be putting tariffs on Canada and Mexico, as well as China. Those three countries in total comprise over one third of the products that are imported into the United States. I'm going to talk about why this is going to hit your pocketbook, why it matters here in the Midwest, where many jobs depend on the auto industry. We're going to get into those tariffs. We're going to talk about what a trade war actually is. We're going to talk about who pays the tariff most of the time. We're also going to talk about what might happen in what they call currency wars or currency devaluation, why that may be a response, especially from a nation like China, to increase tariffs that Donald Trump again promises on day one. I'm also going to talk about what it means to actually hold government officials accountable. What does accountability mean? What does it mean in the second Trump administration? What indicators do we have so far about this relationship between Donald Trump and industry, his appointees, and the industries that they're supposed to regulate and oversee? We're going to discuss all of that because just this week, there seems to be an incredible amount of reporting about indications of what I'm going to call just corruption writ large, and that a lot of these things, positions within the Trump administration, seem to have been for sale. And I don't know about you, whether it's Donald Trump, Joe Biden, Kamala Harris, Barack Obama, I don't care who's in the White House or a governor's mansion. What I don't want them is selling positions in government to the highest bidders. You know, we can talk about the fact that Donald Trump wants loyalists in some of these slots and the pros and cons of that. We can talk about the qualifications of each of and every single one of his appointees, stack them up against prior administration's appointments. But at the end of the day, one of the things I just don't want to see is that important governmental leadership positions are for sale. That's not the way it's supposed to work. We, again, merits aside about loyalties and qualifications for the job, you're not supposed to be able to buy cabinet positions. At least that's not what I think makes for good government. We're going to talk about that. I might even have some thoughts from the Watergate prosecutor, Archibald Cox, that I think resonate today. All of that is coming up today, right here on the Maggie Daun Show. Of course, you've got the great Dom Salvia that follows my show every Monday through Wednesday from 4 to 6 p.m. But let me start. I got Cardi behind the board. If you're going to give us a call, you want to share one of your airport hijink stories. We got a lot of traveling coming up this weekend. Feel free to give us a call. Say hello to Cardi, 855-75-CIVIC. That's 855-752-4842. But Cardi, yes, you're going to get a kick out of this one, as well as everybody else out there. So it is Friday. My flight back from the conference on Friday was really late because there was only one direct flight. And the last thing you're doing if you're flying from St. Louis to Milwaukee is getting a connecting flight. Like, forget that. You might as well drive. You know what I'm saying? So I waited or scheduled my flight for one of the last ones because it was one of the last direct flights. So I had a nice chunk of time after the conference concluded. I was banging out some work, tip, click a clacking at the hotel in the lobby on my laptop, working away. I thought, well, I could go to the airport and do this, but I would be much more uncomfortable. It's quieter here. It smells like jasmine. I love the air fresheners that they seemingly pump into every hotel. I want to get my house to smell like a hotel. Like, how do they get it to smell like jasmine? So I was chilling. I was enjoying just the nice, serene, relaxed vibe in the hotel lobby, getting my work done. So I had plenty of time to get myself to the airport. I had another friend that was finishing up a session sort of post-conference with some of her workmates or her co-workers. And we had decided, hey, let's go grab a bite and then we'll head off to the airport. She was on the same flight that I was on. Nice. So we went at like 5 o'clock, had dinner, flight's at 8 o'clock. It's a 15, 20 minute taxi ride from downtown St. Louis to their airport. So we got our Uber at about 6 o'clock. We had a quick bite, had some St. Louis barbecue. It was delightful, by the way. I love that every region has a very different type of barbecue. I'm a barbecue connoisseur, so I was definitely digging the St. Louis barbecue. So we get in the Uber, right? We're on our way to the airport at 6 o'clock. We got plenty of time. This should be a 15, 20 minute car ride. What happens, my friend? The traffic legit just stops. And we're like two exits from the airport. Dead stop. We're not moving. And it just sits there. They had four lanes of traffic. And you see like the squad cars coming up, like not in lanes, like, you know, just on the shoulders right next to the median. You see the tow trucks coming. Oh, no, bad accident. You see the ambulances show up. We sat there 15 minutes, 20 minutes. Now, of course, folks are the first responders. They're trying to save people's lives. You know, like, please, by all means, go ahead and get that done. But it keeps ticking on. We sit and we sit and we sit. And it's now like 7 o'clock. And because I'm a terrible packer, I travel a lot, but I'm a terrible packer. I just threw in the towel a number of years ago. I was like, I can't get the liquids down to 3 ounces in the quart size bag. So I just check a bag. I forget it. I'm checking a bag. I don't have to worry about the size of my liquids and whatnot. So I still have to check a bag. Now, if my bag doesn't get there with me, no big deal because I'm coming home. But I start to get real nervous because I got my little baby dog at home and I want to get her. I do not have doggy daycare or doggy childcare lined up. She does not like to be left in the house for an extended period of time. Small anatomy animals, for all of you that have small anatomy pets, you know that like the outside amount of time that you can leave them unattended before disaster strikes is about like 3-4 hours, right? Otherwise, there'll be some surprises for me when I arrive home. And the very next day, one of my best friends was in town from AZ. She just had a baby 2 months ago. She actually came on the show about 6-7 months ago and talked about how her and her husband used a surrogate egg. And so she had the egg implanted and gave birth. Anyways, haven't seen Colleen since she had her baby. And I was going to see her on Saturday morning. There was no way I wanted to be stuck in St. Louis overnight in traffic that didn't move for nearly like 45 minutes an hour. So Cardi, would it surprise you one little bit that Maggie Daun got herself out of the Uber in 4-lane like expressway traffic, got my bag out of the back of the car and started hoofing my way across traffic and back up the exit the entrance ramp? Like there was a nearby entrance ramp, like going, let's see, I would be exiting the entrance ramp on foot, past cars, waving at people. I got some hoots and some hollers. People were having a good old chuckle. I get to the very top of the entrance ramp. Again, I'm exiting the entrance ramp on foot off of the St. Louis Expressway. Yes. About to hit call, right, to get the next Uber or whatever. And God bless my driver, Vaughn in St. Louis, my brother. If you are out there, yes, shout out to Vaughn, the Uber driver extraordinaire. Vaughn hits me up on my cell phone and is like, "Mags, it's starting to move. Get your butt back down here." So what does Margaret Dawn do with my backpack and my carry-on? Turns right back around. I'm now running down the entrance ramp to find my Uber, and like now it just looks like headlights. I can't see anything. Right. Vaughn, which one are you by the Mayflower truck, my friend? I am messy. I fully expected myself to show up on like somebody's Facebook feed as like the meme of the week because I was so ridiculous. But God bless you, Vaughn. I appreciate you. I was able to hightail it back down the entrance ramp, find Vaughn, get in the car. Got to the airport about 5-10 minutes later. I certainly hope that everybody that had the accident turned out all right, and I made my flight. But I wasn't leaving that to anybody else's hands except my own. I'm going to grab the old travel beast by the horns, bull by the horns, and make sure I was getting home to the little dog and my friend Colleen and her new baby, Claire. When we come back, folks, I'm going to give you a couple of tips from the Better Business Bureau about Black Friday deals. Then we're going to dig into tariffs, all that and so much more coming up this half hour, as well as some laughs at my expense. I always laugh some laughs at my expense, Cardi. All that coming up right here on the Maggie Daun Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Keep it locked. I'm
telling you. You're listening to Civic Media. Stay up to date on the latest news and information for your local community and Wisconsin by signing up for our free email newsletter. Visit civicmedia.us/email to get started.
Change, change, change. Change, change.
Well, if you were listening to last segment, I certainly looked the fool running all over the expressway in St. Louis. We were talking a little airport hijinks, trying to make my flight out of St. Louis last week. I'm Maggie Daun. You're listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Shout outs to Sherry from Horicon and Dennis from West Dallas. Thanks for checking in on the text line. You too can join our conversation. Just text 855-75-CIVIC. That's 855-752-4842. But if you want to make it even easier on yourself, you go get that Civic Media app, pick WAUK as your home station, and then you can text in or call with just one click off the app. So the text and phone lines are open, 855-75-CIVIC. Again, that's 855-752-4842. We want to hear if you've got any special tips or tricks for maximizing Black Friday deals. Now, Cardi, are you a Black Friday shopper? I've got some family members. They get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and head on out. Is this on your docket for this Thanksgiving weekend? Do you go out on Black Friday?
I'm not going to lie. My wife's pretty much the Black Friday shopper. I'm more of the Cyber Monday type of guy. I'm more the one scrolling through the internet feeds looking to see what I can get the day after the sales are already done.
Yes, I like it. It's the divide and conquer approach. You've got the Cyber right. Monday. She's got Black Friday. I have no wonderful spouse to share the holiday shopping duties with. So
well, you have the dog.
I got the dog. Yeah. We're definitely a family. Right. She does not log in on Black Friday or Cyber Monday. She's like, where are my treats? But I have just adopted a position years ago where I was like, I can't manage it. It stresses me out. Like, I've tried to show up with friends that are super into it. I've tried to go early with some of my family members that really dig that. And by about 10 a.m., my anxiety is at, you know, a 10 out of 10. I am sick of people. I need to go home. It does not work for me. So if I do any of the sales that come around this time of year, I'm more of a Cyber Monday gal as well.
I agree.
I can click in my PJs, you know, from the comfort of my own home.
You're not fighting people over items on the shelf. Like, dude, really? We're going to get this on sale next week, Tuesday.
Yes. Well, now it seems like Black Friday has become like Black Friday month, which then is Cyber Monday, you know. And I also, my family and I, we've moved away from doing presents because I happen to be an only child. So it's just me and my two parents and my little dog. We don't really need to be buying each other more tchotchkes, if you know what I'm saying. Like, I have a slight tchotchke problem already. I have plenty of tchotchkes in my crib. Like, I do not need more things. So we've tried to do more of the Giving Tuesday and hey, let's figure and agree on 2, 3, 4, 5 of our charities that really make an impact locally. And that's kind of where we have decided to spend our money. So there are some folks that I still like to get presents for, but I kind of, when I see it, I know, ooh, this person would really like it. And I generally try to do the shop local thing. So I hit up a lot of the little boutiques and things around. But given that we're coming up on Black Friday, I thought it might make sense for all of you to get the benefit of the tips that the Wisconsin Better Business Bureau put out about these Black Friday deals. Now, a lot of this stuff is common sense, but it always bears repeating because there's always folks out there trying to scam you and steal and take your money. So here are the tips from the Better Business Bureau. And if you want more of these kinds of ideas, more advice about how to help avoid online scams, especially, you can always check out this kind of information. Just Google Wisconsin Better Business Bureau. They have all kinds of great consumer tips there. But here are the basics for Black Friday best practices, again, coming from the Triple B here in Wisconsin. The first one is, and I thought, oh, this makes sense, is have a plan to make the most of the Black Friday deals. So kind of know what your plan of attack is. I do this when I have to go grocery shopping for like a major event, Cardi, you know, where I plot out like, okay, I'm going to go to this grocery store first, and then I'm going to go to this grocery store because I know they've got the specialty stuff. Then I'm going to hit up the liquor store. And I've got the whole order of operations. And yes, folks, you'll not be surprised to find out that I grope my grocery list. I group my grocery list by section in the grocery store. Yes, I'm that anal retentive. But what the Better Business Bureau is suggesting is have a plan. And frankly, I think that plan can include not just what you know those sales to be, and the flyers that you need, if you need discount codes, if there's a difference between online and in-person sale prices, get all that stuff sorted out. I also like to map out the plan of attack. So I'm not driving, you know, from here to Hiawatha trying to get from place to place. So that was their first tip. Second tip from the Better Business Bureau about how to make the most of Black Friday is read the fine print. Many retailers have additional sales or incentives that they'll call doorbusters, but they may exclude certain products. You're going to want to be sure to read the fine print. If you do not know the retailer, if you've not shopped there before, whether you're online or in person, check the reviews. You can always go to bbbbb.org to check out their complaint and review history. That's super, super important. Plan out the excursion. So this is part of that make the plan. Which stores at which time, especially if you know that particular stores are extremely busy at certain points of the day. You're going to want to sign up for the email alerts and the reward programs from those retailers. Here's the big one. Know the gosh darn return policy and warranty information. Have you gotten burned? I get like some great thing on sale. I get it home and it's not exactly the right fit. Doesn't fit in the house. It's not the right size for me. And they have the no return policy. That's never, never fun. Their second to last tip is go online. Make sure you've checked out the prices and sales and deals that you can get for those same products online. Sometimes there are differences. And last but not least, look for the Better Business Bureau seal. It is the sign of a better business. And if you get into any particular spots, again, reach out to the Better Business Bureau at bbb.org. When we come back, we're going to dig into those tariffs. What does it mean for your family's pocketbook? Next on The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
Happy Tuesday, everybody. I'm Maggie Daun. You're listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is deer hunting season, and the Deer Hunters Roundup is here for every single one of you deer hunters out there in the state of Wisconsin. That Deer Hunters Roundup, it's been a Northwoods tradition for over 50 years, each night from 6 to 8 p.m. of the traditional 9-day deer hunting season. With the exception, of course, of the Sunday Packer game and Thanksgiving Thursday, you will find the Deer Hunters Roundup on WCQM, WHSM, WIRI, and of course on the Civic Media app. It's the 25th year of hosting the Deer Hunters Roundup. Joel Karnack leads the nightly two-hour wooded drive with all of his hunting expertise and background. With a bunch of fun and sarcasm and great stories, he is joined by Gary Gunderson and Big G. They're always ready to make your deer hunt even more special. So we're going to be opening up the phone lines. Again, that is 2 hours each day of the deer hunt, except for Thursday, Thanksgiving, and the Sunday Packers game for 2 hours from 6 to 8 p.m. So check that out. Again, you can find that on the Civic Media app and your local Civic Media station in Park Falls, Hayward, or Wisconsin Rapids. Speaking of Thanksgiving, Cardi, I am super excited. Tomorrow, I've got a really special Thanksgiving Eve show. I'm going to be joined by a special co-host for the entire two-hour show. His name's Dan Terrio. He is Native American. He is a two-spirit person. If you don't know what that means, we'll tell you what it means tomorrow. We're going to go over some of the Native American history, specifically here in Wisconsin, talk to Dan about that. And in the second hour, we're going to open it up for all of you, and we're going to have some fun. We're going to talk about your favorite holiday movies. Cardi is putting together some clips from those. We'll name that holiday film. We're going to talk about your favorite holiday treats and recipes. If you've got a favorite Thanksgiving tradition, we're going to share some of those together. And we'll also probably drop some tips to survive your Thanksgiving dinner with your crazy Uncle Fred. Everybody's got one, you know what I'm saying? So we'll talk about that, especially in this post-election environment. So I'm really excited about that. Don't forget to tune in tomorrow. We'll have a very special Thanksgiving Eve episode of the Maggie Daun Show. Cardi and I are also putting together a special show for you all on Thursday. We're trying to get everybody here at Civic Media as much as we can a day off. So we're putting together some special replays for y'all. You'll want to check that out. And on Friday, I'm going to have Jimmy Koska right here in the hot seat, broadcasting from WAUK. He's going to be my special guest host for the Maggie Daun Show. I love Jimmy. He is an absolute treasure here on Civic Media. The guy knows everything about sports that is going on. He is plugged into politics. So if you want to talk about high school or college athletics, local sports here in Wisconsin, Jimmy's your guy. He's going to have a very special show for you on Monday. And then I'll be back in the chair. That'll be on Friday. And then I'll be back in the chair on Monday, bringing you more of the classic Maggie Daun Show hijinks, with, of course, Dom joining me at 3:30 Monday for In Case You Missed It Mondays with Dom Salvia. But with all of that said, obviously yesterday, Donald Trump tweeting out about tariffs that he wants to put in place on day one. Let's have a conversation about that. I think there's a lot of the moving parts about tariffs that people don't really understand. If you've got questions or comments about this, 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. And I don't want to bury the lead here. I think this is really stupid economic policy. And I think this is really stupid economic policy for a number of reasons. We're going to talk in more detail about these, but at an incredibly high level, the bottom line is that the United States is absolutely dependent on its trade agreements and trade relationships with both Canada and Mexico, but also the European Union and, of course, China. And when we impose tariffs, it typically results in some kind of retaliatory tariff from the country we just imposed the tariff on. And you can then sort of get into this domino effect. And it has two impacts. If you end up in a trade war, which is basically tit for tat tariffs being imposed by, say, the United States slaps on an additional 25% tariff on everything that comes imported into the United States from China, China then does the same. What that does is twofold. And I'll talk about why it is more frequently the case that imported goods that are tariffed by the United States, that those costs are passed along to consumers. So it's one, going to drive up prices for consumables. Think electronics, clothing, automobiles, anything that is might be the final manufacturing might occur in the United States, but the parts are getting imported. Yeah, all that stuff. And let's be honest, if you're in the middle class, you work for a living, you're going to be spending a bigger portion of your paycheck on these sorts of consumables. So again, trade wars have this impact of driving up prices for consumer goods that most of us spend big chunks of our paychecks on if you're in the middle class. That's impact one. Impact two is that when those other countries impose those retaliatory tariffs, what happens? It makes it harder for U.S. manufacturers to export their goods and services abroad because those products are now more expensive. Those are reasons number one and number two why I think it's just stupid economic policy. The reasons that Donald Trump is citing, you know, to stop immigration, to stop the flow of fentanyl. Tariffs don't do that. He's trying to make the argument that by putting these really extreme tariffs in place, that it will so hurt the economy of these countries, Canada, Mexico, China, first on his hit list, that they will be incentivized to, quote, stop fentanyl or stop immigration. But the reality is that those aren't light switches that the Chinese government has, or that the Canadian government has, or that the Mexican government has. That stemming the flow of fentanyl into this country is actually quite difficult. Now, has China done everything that it can? No. Does it need to do more? Yes. But getting into a trade war with China, I'm not sure that that incentive gets the result that Donald Trump is promising all of us. Similarly, when you look at Mexico and Canada, there's no magic immigration switch that the Mexican president has. That just doesn't exist. So we're going to get into some of that. So I think, again, higher prices, harder for American manufacturers to export their goods. And we export a ton of goods to Mexico, Canada, and China. It won't actually result in the outcomes that Donald Trump is promising. And it is incredibly destabilizing for business. It's incredibly destabilizing for our overall economy. Markets were down on some of this news. They're not exactly sure what's going to happen. Even Donald Trump's appointees to become Treasury Secretary and the Secretary of Commerce said that they prefer phased in tariffs. They'll both support tariffs. Now, Cardi, if you could check out the phone lines, be sure that if folks want to get their two cents in, puns intended, their two cents on this tariff discussion, you can join us 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. And Cardi, I'll just remind you to be sure that you mute your mic when you're picking up those phone calls, because otherwise I can hear your lovely greetings to all of our wonderful callers. Again,
hey,
you want to join
Jack. We have Jack from Merrimack.
We do have Jack from Merrimack. Well, let's see how Jack's doing. I love me some Jack from Merrimack. Remember, if you want to join our conversation, call and text lines are open. It is, Jack. How are you, friend?
Oh, just peachy keen, thank you. I have a comment or three about these tariffs that are being proposed by the Trump administration. First of all, I thought they did tariffs the last time, and wasn't there something about a problem with the farmers' exports, and they had to put something like $30 billion into subsidies for farmers so that they didn't take a huge hit on that? That's the first question.
Yes, there. I think it was closer to $12 billion in direct subsidies to U.S. farmers as a result of Trump's first administration's imposition of tariffs. It absolutely tanked the ability for U.S. farmers to export a lot of our agricultural products. We are an exporting country in many particular agricultural products, including soybeans, which is a huge product coming out of the Midwest, especially Iowa. So yes, you saw massive subsidies, direct payments from the government. You know, some people might call those handouts subsidies to farmers that they desperately needed because of the retaliatory tariff, not just because of the U.S. tariff, but it was the tariff that was then placed on U.S., for example, soybean exports. So you're right on the money about that one, Jack. Please continue.
Okay. Yeah. The second thing I have to say is those people that, like I, really appreciate Apple products. Boy, you think an iPhone's expensive now? Wait till they get tariffs coming against China on an iPhone. Jack up that price 25%. I wonder what's going to happen to Apple and Apple stock. Not to mention other companies, of course, that'll be affected.
Yeah, your point's extremely well taken. Again, when you make things more expensive, classic microeconomic theory tells you that demand will decrease. So again, if you sort of work this out, the cause and effect of retaliatory tariffs in a trade war, it will have overall a basically depressing impact on the amount of products sold by U.S. businesses, U.S.-based businesses, and those businesses that employ U.S. workers. They will just be less consumed because prices for things will go up. One thing that I'll mention here, Jack, very briefly, is that one way for countries to combat tariffs that are imposed by their trading partners is to actually devalue their currency. Now, in a nation like the United States, where we've had an independent Treasury Department and an independent, not independent Treasury, an independent federal bank, which let's see if that continues, that wouldn't happen. But in a centrally controlled economy like China, economists are predicting that that China will do what it did when Donald Trump put the first round of tariffs on during his first administration, and they forcibly devalued their currency. When your currency is worth less versus the dollar, it actually can mute or minimize the impact of tariffs that are imposed by your trading partner. Jack, I believe you had a third point. And folks, if you want to join this conversation, 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. Go ahead, Jack, very briefly.
Okay. If you mess with the economy of a country, generally unlawful operations increase. And one real moneymaker is illegal drug. My guess is that if anything, this will have the exact opposite effect if it has a negative effect on the economy in countries like that.
It's an excellent point, and I hadn't even gotten there yet, Jack. This is why you, the callers, each and every one of you out there, make this show so much better when we have these real, these great conversations. And that is the black market. Trade demand is one of those things, especially when it's demand for drugs. You limit legal importation, you try to shut down importation, the products will find a way into your country, including black markets, for all of these other consumables. Think knockoff Apple phones and all those kinds of things. We're going to pick it right back up where we are leaving it after these brief messages. Keep it locked right here on the Maggie Daun Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Your calls and texts are next. 855-75-CIVIC. That's 855-752-4842. More on tariffs.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
What is going on, y'all? I'm Maggie Daun. You're listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. We're talking tariffs and trade wars because it matters to you and your pocketbook in a big, big way. To refresh our recollection, during Trump's first term, a type of trade war did actually get ignited. Now, it wasn't as broad as what would be expected if his just announced tariff plan for increased tariffs on Canadian, Mexican, and Chinese products going into effect. But the last time around, it wasn't just soybeans. It was American whiskey, orange juice, motorcycles, some auto parts. Those exports plummeted. Again, there was this domino effect. It was a bad deal. Also, economists have analyzed what occurred to for consumers after the first rounds of tariffs during Donald Trump's first term. And indeed, those costs were passed on to consumer. Here are some facts. Again, more than one third of the stuff that we buy, imports, come from Canada, Mexico, and China combined. That's going to make all of that stuff more expensive nearly overnight. And this, consider this. We export to those three countries over $1 trillion worth of U.S. goods. So if they engage in retaliatory tariffs, those manufacturers, those U.S.-based manufacturers, aren't going to sell as much of their stuff in those other countries. Again, it's around $1.5 trillion of imports from those three countries, $1 trillion of our exports. Again, you see lower supply that leads to price spikes. You can see bankruptcy and job losses. The industries that will be impacted by these tariffs, again, just Mexico, China, and Canada, those are tens of millions of U.S. jobs. That's what we're looking at. And oh, by the way, these very tariffs would violate the terms of the North American trade agreement that Donald Trump himself negotiated back in 2020. So, you know, there's that. The Mexican president announced this morning that, of course, they would engage in retaliatory tariffs. So they've promised to do that, the thing that I am very concerned about. And just to be clear, listen, the importer of the product is who pays a tariff. So it is the U.S.-based business that pays the tariff when a good gets imported from China. So when they then turn around and sell that product to you or sell it to a manufacturer that uses it in a part in something that you ultimately buy, they only have three options. They either eat the cost of the tariff, right? They could try to force the foreign supplier to eat the cost by negotiating a lower price for their product. That's very hard to do, especially when you have longer term supply or demand-based contracts set up. And lastly, the easiest way is you pass the cost on to consumers. That's what happens. Auto industry experts are calling this a five-alarm fire for the auto industry. Really, really spooky. Let's go to the phone lines. Brendan, you're on the Maggie Daun Show. What say you, my friend? Hey, Brendan, you there? Go ahead, sir.
Oh, hello. Hey. Sorry. So when it comes to those tariffs, thinking about it from a perspective, a middle-class perspective, wouldn't it be better for us to have the Chinese and other foreign countries, maybe not Canada and Mexico, but certainly countries like China, make less money from them, have us be in less debt from a foreign country like that?
So what debt are you talking about? This is not governmental debt, right? This is private. Yep. Are you talking about like a trade deficit?
Yes, from a trade deficit.
So trade deficit. Great question, Brendan. Thank you so much. Trade deficits themselves aren't really a big deal. It doesn't indicate a plus or a minus for a country's overall GDP or even for middle-class families. It matters, are the businesses that employ middle-class folks in this country, are they going to stay open? Are they able to pay higher wages, right? The things that impact your pocketbooks. My argument is, once you place those tariffs, those companies are going to sell fewer products. When you're selling fewer products, because your supply costs have gone up, guess what? You don't pay people more. You fire workers. I predict there's going to be job losses. So just to be clear, the trade deficit itself doesn't really mean much from an economic perspective. It does matter if and how businesses are paying their workers and whether or not they're going to be employing more or paying them more. And that's fundamentally the problem here, as well as the fact that your dollar simply will not go as far as it has in the past. Last point on this, and again, great question, Brendan. When you think about trade deficits, Donald Trump keeps saying, well, like, I'm going to bring all these businesses back to the United States. That doesn't happen overnight, if it happens at all. And there are many businesses that are so now enmeshed in the supply chain with the labor forces, with production in these foreign countries, they've invested a ton that it's impossible or very difficult and at best slow for them to bring their businesses back here stateside. Dick from Madison, you got about 30 seconds, my friend. Have at it.
Building products, especially lumber, the last time I had a friend who's a builder, it kind of stifled that too. And what it's going to do ultimately is it's going to turn around and spike inflation again. Yeah. We're just now rounding the corner towards, I don't know. I just don't quite understand what happened.
Yeah, it's going to be economic chaos, and it is not going to go well for the middle class. Economic chaos always taxes, both metaphorically and literally, the middle class most and worst. I'm going to give a shout out to many of the text messages when we come back from the top of the hour break. We can complete this conversation. We're then going to be joined by Dan Schaefer, political editor of Civic Media.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.